Chapter 1 of Rational Theology, as taught by the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Rational Theology, as taught by the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, by John Andreas Widtsoe. Chapter 1. The Meaning of Theology. Earth, stars, and the vastness of space, yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and the endless increasing knowledge of the relations of forces present an illimitable universe of numberless phenomena. Only as a whole and in general outline can the human mind understand the universe. In its infinite variety of expressions, it wholly transcends the human mind. Man in the universe. In the midst of this complexity, man finds himself. As he progresses from childhood to manhood, and as his slumbering faculties are awakened, he becomes more fully aware of the vastness of his universe, and of the futility of hoping to understand it in detail. Nevertheless, conscious man can not endure confusion. From out the universal mystery, he must draw at least the general controlling laws that proclaim order in the apparent chaos. And especially is he driven by his inborn and unalterable nature to know, if he can, his own place in the system of existing things. Every normal man desires and seeks an understanding of his relationship to all other things, and practically every man has worked out for himself, on the basis of his knowledge, some theory which explains more or less satisfactorily the mystery of star and earth and man and life. No other quest is followed by man with such vigorous persistence as is that of establishing an intelligible and satisfactory philosophy of earth life. Man's religion. The philosophy or system of thought adopted to explain man's place in nature determines largely the joy and manner of a man's life. If the philosophy be poor and loose, life will be confused. If rich and firm, life will be clear-cut. And if law be made supreme, life will be orderly. Those who have no religion at all become the playthings of unknown forces. Every act of a man's life is influenced by the philosophy of his life. It is the most important product of an individual life, and is the most compelling power in life. In a broad sense, the philosophy according to which a man orders his life may be called that man's religion. It may or may not involve the idea of God or an organized body of believers. If it guides a life, it is that life's religion, whether it leads to weakness or to strength. Theology defined. Since all men are placed in the same universe, with approximately the same powers, and under conditions nearly alike, it is possible for each person to establish for himself a religion as above defined for the guidance of his life. All religions must be organized from the content of the one, and so far as we know, the only, universe. And the presumption would be, therefore, that the religions of all men should be the same, in as far at least as men are the same. In fact, however, during the course of human history, many more or less dissimilar religions have been established and accepted. True, most of these religions show close kinship, but the vital differences are often very great. For instance, the religions of men fall naturally into two great classes. Those that adopt as their central idea a great governing intelligence and a power, a God, and those that refuse to include a God in their system of thought. A religion which accepts the idea of a God is a theology. The great majority of the religions of men are theologies, for the majority of men believe in some form of personal divine power. The Gospel. The word gospel is also frequently used among Christians to designate the religion of men. The gospel is a theology which includes the doctrine of the life and mission of Jesus Christ as the Son of God. Among Christians, the words religion, theology, and gospel are freely used in the same sense. It is well, however, to bear in mind the distinction in meaning of the three words. The Christian religion, the Christian theology, and the gospel are equivalent in meaning. In the following pages, the terms are often used interchangeably without the qualifying words. Indeed, the gospel will be used most frequently, and wherever used, it must be understood to stand for the rational theology discussed in this book. The purpose of this book. This volume is devoted to the exposition of the fundamental principles of a rational theology, a philosophy of life which, because of its complete harmony with all knowledge, should be the one to which all men might give adherence. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of Rational Theology as Taught by the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints by John Andreas Widtsoe. Chapter 2. How Knowledge is Gained. Knowledge is the material upon which the reasoning mind of man acts. Just as physical strength can neither be developed nor exercised unless material bodies are at hand, so mental strength can neither be developed nor exercised unless facts or knowledge are in man's possession. The acquisition of knowledge or experience is the first step towards formulating an acceptable religion. It is of interest, therefore, to consider briefly the sources of human knowledge. The senses. Through eyes, ears, nose, the sense of taste, and the complex and poorly understood sense of feeling, man becomes acquainted with the universe. That which is seen by the eyes, heard by the ears, smelled by the nose, tasted by the mouth, or felt by any part of the body, becomes impressed and registered upon the mind, there later to be used. The detailed method by which knowledge is added to man is not understood. The theories that prevail concerning the entrance of knowledge into the human mind need not here be discussed. It follows that the man who wishes to gain much knowledge must guard his senses from harm and must sharpen them so that during the few days of life they may do as much as is possible to help a man establish a rational religion for his guidance. The foundation of human knowledge is derived from the direct action of the senses. The sixth sense. Important as are the senses in adding knowledge to man, yet it must be admitted that they recognize without help only a very small part of the universe. Our universe is infinite in its variety of expression. Of that man feels certain, and it could hardly be expected, therefore, that man, who admittedly is yet far from perfection, should be able to know, even with the greatest aid, all of the universe. The truth that an immeasurable part of the universe lies outside of human experience is borne in upon every thinking man. In recent times, the developments of science have emphasized this vast region of the unknown. The mystery of electricity in the telephone and telegraph, the wonder of space in wireless telegraphy, the marvel of the elements, speak clearly of places and conditions of which we as yet have no clear and accurate conception, and before which the senses of man, unaided, stand helpless. Nevertheless, glimpses into this unknown region may be had by helps to the senses. By the telescope, the far is brought near. By the microscope, the small is made large. By the photographic plate, unseen light is made visible. By the well-turned coil of wire, the wireless message is taken out of space. By the spectroscope, light is broken into its elements, and so on, through almost the whole field of human endeavor. Facts that are gathered in such an indirect way are as correctly certain as are those that are sensed directly. The world would lose tremendously should all the truth gathered through aids to the senses be removed. Man himself, through what may be called, for want of a better name, the sixth sense, may become a great aid to his own direct senses. By proper exertion, he may intercept messages from out the directly unknown, as completely as this may be done by man-made instruments. Throughout history, this power of man has been recognized and usually respected. The experience or knowledge thus gained should, when properly examined by the mind, be given an equal place beside that gained directly through the commoner senses. Prophets, poets, men of vision and faith have all builded their work largely upon this kind of knowledge or inward feeling. Transmitted knowledge. The inexhaustible universe and the limited powers of man make it possible for a person to discover for himself relatively a very small amount of truth. Much effort may be saved and more knowledge gained if each person learn as much as he may of what has already been learned, to which he may add the little new discovery that he may make. This method of obtaining knowledge has been in vogue since the first day. What the first man learned, he told to others, and they in turn communicated it, with the addition of whatever new knowledge they had gained. Thus comes the present value of tradition, the spoken record, and of books, the written record. Men who desire to build a safe religion or a safe science make themselves familiar with as much as they can of what is already known, instead of attempting to traverse the known field as original discoverers, and to this transmitted knowledge they add whatever in the course of their pursuit they may discover independently. Those who in the present day will accept only what they themselves discover will make slow progress. To them the treasuries of the greatest age will not be opened. If in the course of events it becomes necessary for God to speak to a man for the benefit of many, it would be contrary to rational thinking that each man for whom the message was given should directly hear God's voice, unless indeed the means of communicating the knowledge became effectually blocked. Such transmitted knowledge is every whit as sound as that acquired by direct communion with nature. True, the knowledge already possessed by man is so large that it can in no wise be transmitted in all its details to one man. The efforts of humanity are directed, therefore, to the devising of general statements or laws which embody the meaning of a multitude of facts while they are yet easily intelligible to the human mind. More and more important will become the repositories of such general principles containing the knowledge of mankind. The Bible, in its various books, presents such great underlying principles of our knowledge relating to several very important phases of earth life. The use of reason. Whether knowledge be obtained by any or all of the methods indicated, it should be carefully examined in the light of reason. The only knowledge that will help in the establishment of a satisfactory religion is true knowledge. Truth is the end of the search. False or apparently true knowledge often intrudes itself upon the attention, and at times it is so well disguised as to be dangerously deceptive. Man must learn of the universe precisely as it is, or he cannot successfully find his place in it. A man should therefore use his reasoning faculty in all matters involving truth, and especially as concerning his religion. The foundation of rational theology. The gospel, or rational theology, is founded on truth, on all truth, for, quote, truth is knowledge of things as they are, and as they were, and as they are to come, end quote, and, quote, truth has no end, end quote. In building a philosophy of life, a man, therefore, cannot say that some truth must be considered and other truth rejected. Only on the basis of all truth, that is, all true knowledge, can his religion be built. Further, the perfection of his knowledge, that is, the extent of his truth possessions, will determine the value of his religion to him. Therefore, quote, it is impossible for a man to be saved in ignorance, end quote. Quote, a man is saved no faster than he obtains knowledge, end quote. And, quote, the glory of God is intelligence. End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 of Rational Theology, as taught by the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, by John Andreas Widtsoe. Chapter 3. Eternalism. The conceptions necessary for logical thought belong to the gospel as well as to science, for a satisfactory life philosophy must be based on all knowledge known to man. All knowledge, the basis. The gospel, as the largest knowledge, must include the knowledge of all sciences. The conceptions of time and space are quite as necessary in theology as in natural science or in any other branch of human thought. The gospel does not claim, however, possession of ultimate knowledge concerning space or time or other fundamental conceptions. Indeed, man is ordinarily allowed to work out for himself the truths of the universe and to organize them into systems of thought which he may follow profitably. Knowledge is given directly by superior intelligence only when it becomes indispensable. Moreover, there are innumerable phenomena in the universe which could not be explained by the human understanding as at present developed. The distinguishing feature of the gospel is that it possesses the key to the final philosophy of life. In outline, it offers the entire plan of life in the universe. And man may gauge for all time to come in the elaboration and development of each department of this great universal plan of human life without requiring an expansion of the outline. The plan is complete. Eternal matter. The saddest feature of man-made religions is their lack of security. One man constructs one theology, another a different one, and men flock hither and thither, accepting the one that appears for the moment to be the best, without deeply feeling that the one finally accepted is absolutely the one and only correct system of thought. Yet this is logically absurd, for a house is either red or not red, a stick is straight or not straight, a man has truth or only the semblance of truth. Two different truths cannot be parallel with respect to the same thing. The final philosophy of life must be based on irrevocable truth. That which is true must always remain true, though the applications may change greatly from generation to generation. It is the absence of such fundamental certainties, no doubt, that leads men into a new search for a satisfying religion or that drives them away from their old theology. The gospel of Jesus Christ is obviously a system founded on unvarying certainties. Its doctrines rest on demonstrated truths that lie at the foundation of all sound, acceptable thinking. For instance, as a cornerstone of theology, the gospel recognizes, in connection with the existence of space and time, the existence of matter. Without matter, the mind of man would have no material on which to act. And the existence of matter becomes, therefore, a fundamental conception of the gospel. It is the business of man to become acquainted with matter in all its forms, so far as may be possible, in order to provide a foundation on which the reasoning mind of man may increasingly build its power. The gospel holds strictly to the conception of a material universe. Much inconsistency of thought has come from the notion that things occur in a material and an immaterial state. This unthinkable condition has been made the basis of doctrines concerning God and man, which have led to utter confusion of thought. The gospel accepts the natural view, supported by all human experience, that matter occurs in many forms, some visible to the eye, others invisible, and yet others that may not be sensed by any of the senses of man. In short, there is no such thing as immaterial matter, but some forms of matter are more refined than others. Light, heat, and other similar forces are held by science to be manifestations of a subtle state of matter, beyond the immediate senses of man, which has been called ether. In fact, matter as ordinarily known, and ether, a finer form of matter, are everyday conceptions of science. The material universe may appear in a variety of forms, but man recognizes directly only that form which is the ordinary matter of our daily lives. Universal matter is indestructible. Matter is eternal. that is, everlasting. Whether the various forms of matter may be converted one into the other is not definitely known. Any such conversion would, however, leave the total quantity of matter unchanged. God, the supreme power, cannot conceivably originate matter. He can only organize matter. Neither can he destroy matter. God is the master who, because of his great knowledge, knows how to use the elements already existing for the building of whatever he may have in mind. The doctrine that God made the earth or man from nothing becomes therefore an absurdity. The doctrine of the indestructibility of matter makes possible much theological reasoning that would be impossible without this doctrine. The nature of matter is not, in and of itself, a subject of deep concern in practical religion. By the slow, laborious methods of man's search for truth, the nature of matter will gradually be revealed. Whether it shall be found to be something distinct, or a form of the universal energy, will not be of consequence in the gospel structure. That matter, whatever it is eternal, is, however, a principle of highest theological value, for it furnishes a foundation for correct reasoning. Eternal energy. Matter, wherever found and in whatever form, always possesses energy. It is frequently said that matter in motion only can impress the human mind. Matter without motion, were it conceivable, could not be recognized by the human mind as at present constituted. Matter is always associated with energy, energy with matter. It is not conceivably possible to separate them. Whether one is a manifestation of the other, so that there is only matter or only energy, or if they are distinct things, we do not know. All sound thought recognizes, however, the existence of energy throughout the universe. Energy appears in many forms, such as heat, light, electricity, magnetism, gravitation, and, according to the gospel, the many spiritual forces. These various forms of energy seem to be convertible, one into the other, thus indicating the existence of one central force, of which all other forces are manifestations. The question of energy will probably be answered gradually as the knowledge of man increases. Of one thing the gospel, as well as science, is perfectly certain, namely, that the energy in the universe is indestructible. Changed it may be, from heat to light, from light to electricity, from electricity to magnetism, or from any form to any other form of energy, but destroyed it cannot be. Like matter, energy had no beginning and can have no end. God, possessing the supreme intelligence of the universe, can use energy in accomplishing his ends, but create it or destroy it, he cannot. Undiminished, ever-acting universal energy will continue through all times. Universal intelligence. In one particular, however, the gospel goes beyond the teachings of modern science. The gospel teaches that, associated with the universal energy that vivifies universal matter, and possibly identified with it, is universal intelligence, a force which is felt wherever matter and energy are found, which is everywhere. The forces of the universe do not act blindly, but are expressions of a universal intelligence. That a degree of intelligence is possessed by every particle of energized matter cannot be said, nor is it important. The great consideration is that, since intelligence is everywhere present, all the operations of nature, from the simplest to the most complex, are the products of intelligence. We may even conceive that energy is only intelligence, and that matter and intelligence, rather than matter and energy, are the two fundamentals of the universe. Eternal intelligence. Throughout the universe are found, in addition to indestructible matter, everlasting energy and universal intelligence pervading space. Quote, man was also in the beginning with God, end quote. The doctrine that man is an eternal being leads to untold possibilities. Eternal man lived a personal life before the earth life began, and he continues a personal existence hereafter. The eternal relationship. The phenomena of the universe result from the interaction of matter, energy, and intelligence. These fundamental universal elements are forever acting upon each other to produce the infinite variety of the universe. Nevertheless, space is not filled with disorder. Chaos does not prevail. On the contrary, the universe, so far as known, is essentially orderly. This comes from the great law of cause and effect. If energy acts on matter in a given way, a definite effect is obtained. Under like conditions, the same cause will forever give the same effect. Where, therefore, like conditions are permanently operating, like results will always be found. This law lies at the foundation of the orderliness of nature. Quote, "There is a law irrevocably decreed in heaven upon which all blessings are predicated, and it is only by obedience to this law that any blessing may be obtained." End quote. An eternal plan. The gospel itself, the so-called plan of salvation or great plan, in obedience to which men guide their earth lives, is eternal. It is not a temporary or transient thing, made primarily for the handful of men and women on earth, but it is an eternal plan based upon the everlasting relationship of the elements of the universe, a plan which, in some form, has adapted everywhere and forever for the advancement of personal beings. This must be so, for it leads to a definite end, and in accordance with the law of cause and effect, it must have a universal meaning. Eternalism. The gospel is founded on tangible and eternal things and relationships. These eternal realities, no doubt, in their essence, lie beyond the full understanding of man, just as time and space transcend human understanding. This conception, carried far enough, leads to a gospel or life philosophy which is unshakable because it rests upon eternal certainty. Without certainty, man is, in the great affairs of life, merely the driftwood of existence, moved hither and thither by the wind of doubt. The gospel may be said to be the philosophy of eternalism. The gospel is immersed in the ocean of eternity. End of chapter 3. Chapter 4 of Rational Theology, as taught by the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, by John Andreas Widtsoe. Chapter 4. The Will of Man. The doctrine of the eternal nature of man is most characteristic of the gospel. It is a doctrine which gives great satisfaction to all who have accepted the gospel. The primeval condition. All that is really clear to the understanding is that man has existed, quote, from the beginning, end quote, and that from the beginning he has possessed distinct individuality impossible of confusion with any other individuality among the hosts of intelligent beings.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.